A warm welcome to One and All gathered here virtually. Welcoming you for this session 1 of day 2. This session is handled by Dr. R. Arulraj, Assistant Professor, EEE from King's College of Engineering. I am extremely happy to introduce our resource person, Dr. R. Arulraj. Dr. R. Arulraj was born in Chidambaram, Tamil Nadu in 1988. He received his BE degree in Electrical and Electronics Engineering from SSN College of Engineering, Kalavakkam in 2010. ME degree in Power System Engineering from Annamalai University in 2013 and a PhD degree under UGC India National Fellowship in Electric and Electronics Engineering from Annamalai University in 2019. He is currently working as an assistant professor in Department of EEE in King's College of Engineering, Pudukkottai. He has published more than 16 research papers which involve SCI indexed and ESCI indexed international journals and Web of Science indexed IEEE international conferences. Two of his IEEE conference papers received Science and Engineering Research Board International Travel Support Government of India Award for presentation in IEEE Congress on Evolutionary Computation organized at Vancouver, Canada in 2016 and Rio de Janeiro, Brazil in 2018. He received a Best Paper Award in 2nd International Conference on Intelligent and Efficient Electrical System organized at PSG College of Technology, Coimbatore in 2017. He is a reviewer of IEEE International Conferences and other reputed international journals. His current research interests include distributed generation, power system planning, evolutionary algorithms, single and multi-objective based optimization in power system studies. We welcome you, sir. Now onwards, the session will be handled by our resource person.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot. A very good morning to One and All present here. Okay. In this session, we are going to see the optimization techniques, okay, which are used for power system studies. So, I am going to give the introduction about optimization techniques in this particular session. Okay, I am going to give a general introduction, okay, about optimization techniques, and then after the general introduction, after the things which are all, after studying the things which are all involved in observing the optimization techniques, I will move to application, okay, which is electrical application. Since I am from electrical engineering, I am going to show you an application. Okay, electrical application in which the optimization technique is involved. Okay, so let me share my screen now. Is my voice audible to everyone? Okay, before going to the introduction about optimization techniques, okay, anyone from the session, can you tell me what is an optimization technique? Why we are using optimization technique? Any idea on that? Any idea on that? Okay. I will tell you what is an optimization technique in the simplest form. Okay. It is choosing an optimal input. Okay. That results in the best possible output. Okay. The thing is, you may have n number of inputs for a particular problem. Okay. For example, let me take a simple design problem. Okay. I have to design a bridge. Okay, so that it can withstand the maximum loading. Okay, so for that design problem, I have n number of inputs. Okay, I can have a different kinds of design to construct the particular bridge. But which input is more optimal for me so that the bridge can withstand the more number of load? And for that purpose, we will go for optimization. Okay, that's what I am telling. In n number of inputs, choosing which input is more optimal to get the desired best possible. Okay, that is what optimization is. So, what are all the things involved in optimization? How we can give an example for optimization means you can decide the most effective allocation from available resources. The simplest example is, let me tell you, nowadays we are all familiar with online shopping. I think so. Okay, if you are ordering a particular product in Amazon or Flipkart or whatever online shopping agent is there, in case if I am ordering a particular object, a particular thing from Pudukkottai, okay, right now my location is Pudukkottai, and I am ordering a headset or whatever mobile phone from this particular location. What this optimization algorithm will do is, it will search and it will find the warehouse which is very closer to my location. Okay, For example, if my warehouse is located in Tanjavur, okay, for Amazon, the warehouse is located in Tanjavur, and also it is located in Tiruchi also. But which location is very closer to Pudukkote? It is Tanjavur. Okay, so what will do the algorithm? What it will do means it will pick the location which is closer to my location, Pudukkote. It will pick Tanjavur instead of Tiruchi. Okay, that is the best possible solution for me. Okay, to receive the product as early as possible. So that way, okay, it will the algorithm will choose the best possible input to get the desired output. Okay, so they are using optimization algorithm in all these online shopping models. Okay, so that a particular customer can receive the product at their desk. Okay, so that is one thing. Then to produce a design at the best characteristics. For this only, I have given you an example of designing a particular bridge. Okay, bridge which is so that it can handle maximum amount of loading. Okay, so that how we can produce a design based on this optimization technique. Okay, and also to choose control variables that cause the system to be anywhere beside. Okay, control variables is one of the important part of this optimization technique. I will explain that elaborately in the upcoming slides. Okay, nothing to worry. So coming to the optimization problem. Okay, whenever we are talking about optimization or optimization problem, the most important word that keeps on popping up is minimize or maximize. Okay, it should be either this one or that one. Okay, so most of the problems based on our need or based on our application, the problem may vary. Okay, for some problem it may be a minimization problem, whereas for some other applications it will be a maximization problem. That too we will see some examples. Okay, so the next thing after that minimization or maximization part, the next thing which we will see in any optimization problem is limits or constraints. Okay, it is very, very important. I am going to maximize a particular objective, or else I am going to minimize a particular objective function. How I can maximize, how I can minimize? It is based on a limit. Okay, if I am not providing any limit, okay, I will get n number of inputs and n number of solutions. It is really difficult to obtain an optimal solution. Okay, so the range, if you are not mentioning any range, then it is really difficult to solve the optimization problem. So in any optimization problem, the limits and the constraints, which is nothing but a range. Okay, it is very, very important. Okay, boundaries is nothing but the limits or constraints. In other words, you can call it as boundaries. Boundaries are also very important to restrict the possible solutions. That's what I am telling. We can get only possible optimal solution only if we have the limits and constraints. Okay, if the limits and constraints are not specified, it is really difficult to obtain the optimal solution. Okay, so I have shown you two graphs here. Okay, two parabolas. One is a normal parabola, other is inverted. Okay, so you can see here in maximization problem. Okay, I have to identify the maximum value of the particular curve. You can see here where the maximum point is. Likewise, in the minimization problem, I have to identify the minimize point. Okay, so these are some examples using a simple parabolic curve. Okay, the next slide here we have shown you limits. Okay, so the limits is nothing but a range of boundaries. Within this limits only, I am going to evaluate my objective function. Okay, so those are all some simple pictorial representations. Okay, now a simple example for an optimization problem. Okay, I have shown you a very, very simple example for optimization problem. If you understand this, okay, it will be very, you can understand the fundamental of optimization problem. Okay, you can see a graph here. Okay, in x-axis I have a value of x, and y-axis I have y values. You can see I have plotted a parabola. Okay, I have plotted a parabola. So in that you can see for a change in x, I can have a change in y. Okay, initially you can see up to the peak of the parabola, if I am increasing my x, or my y also increases. Okay, so what it indicates, if I am taking a slope for this particular curve, okay, what happens, how the slope will be? The slope will be positive or negative? Yeah, automatically the slope is going to be positive. Okay, once it reaches the maximum point, okay, and after that you start, the graph is going to decrease. Okay, so what happens? If I am increasing the x beyond the best x value, what will happen? my X, I am increasing the X, my Y will get decrease. Okay, what it indicates means in that particular part, my slope is going to be negative. So, in this particular optimization problem, I am going to identify the best value of X so that I can attain a maximum Y value. Okay, here this is the maximization problem. I need to attain the maximum value of Y. Okay, for that, what is my input? You can see at a particular value of X, I can attain the maximum Y. Okay, this is okay. By looking into the curve, I can easily tell at this particular part of X, I have this maximum value of Y. How come you identify using mathematical expression? Using mathematical expression, you can simply take a first order derivative of this particular parabolic curve so that when the slope is equal to zero, that is the point you will get the maximum Y value. Am I right or wrong? Say yes or no? Because you can attain a slope value, okay, for all the points in this parabolic curve except that maximum value, because at that particular point the Y is going to be constant. Okay, the value of Y is going to be constant. And if you are taking a derivative for Y at that particular point, that is dou Y by dou X, you will get a value equal to zero. Am I right or wrong? So when the slope is zero, that is when you will get the maximum value. Okay. So this problem is very easy to solve. By taking a first order derivative, I can simply say it is, I can attain the maximum point at a particular value for a particular value of X. This is easy to solve. In case, if it is a complex problem, if I am having more than one variables instead of having X, okay, my problem dimension is going to increase. Here I am a two dimensional problem. In case I am having three, four, or five dimensional problem, it is really difficult to attain the maximum value using a simple first order derivative. Okay, so it will be very difficult. So for that purpose only, we are going to use the optimization method. Okay, so this is a simple example. Okay, I am using a parabolic curve. This the equation for this particular curve is y equal to minus x square. Okay, if I am taking the first order derivative, the dou y by dou x, okay, and equating and if I am check at which point this derivative is going to be zero, I can identify the maximum. Okay, because at the maximum point, you can see the value of best y. The value of y is going to be constant. And because of the constant y value, I'm going to get my slope as zero. Okay, my first order derivative is going to be zero. So I can take that point as maximum value. This is a simple mathematical analytical way of identifying the solution for an optimization problem. Okay, but this is for a simple problem. In case it is a complex problem, it is really difficult to identify the best solution with a simple first order derivative. Okay, for the purpose only, we are going to use the optimization number. Okay. So, I'm going to show you some few real-time optimization examples. Okay, the first one is the optimal location of values. This is what, this example is what I have told you just earlier. Okay, I'm going to put some order. Okay, so that the algorithm will identify the best possible location of arrows nearer to my location so that I can get the delivery of the particular product as early as possible. Okay, so arrows placement is one of the real-time optimization example. Okay, so what is the input here? The input here is arrows location. I need to give the arrows location of different arrows locations as an input. Okay, what is my objective function? What is my thing? Minimum shipment time. Okay, that's what I have told. Okay, for my optimization problem, my input is the location of arrows. I have number of arrows at different locations. So, also I am going to give it as an input. Okay, so once the input is received by the optimization problem, what is the objective? Objective is to minimize the time of shipment. So, for that, which input is more optimal? That will be decided by the optimization problem. Okay, that's what I told. In case payment for the quota, and I am putting an order in Amazon or Flipkart or whatever online platform it is. Okay. So what this algorithm will do is it will take the arrows locations of the input. Okay, and its main objective is to reduce the shipment time. It will choose the location appropriately so that the product will get to me at the earliest possible. Okay. So this is one real-time example. The other one is bridge design. This is also I have told you. Okay, I am going to design a bridge. So that the design of the bridge will maximize the loading capability of the particular bridge. So likewise, my input is my design parameters. I can give those parameters as input, and my objective is to attain a maximum load bearing. Okay, so that the optimization will, algorithm will design accordingly. For a particular design value, I can get a maximum load, maximized load theory. Okay, this is another example. The third one is in terms of medical medicinal terms. So this the one more thing is here you can see this location of arrows is based on business side. This bridge design is based on mechanical side. And even this one, control of insulin, is based on medical side. Why I am showing this examples in different domains is, the reason is optimization algorithm has its influence on each and every domain. Okay, it is not domain specific. It is not that only electrical people can use optimization. It is not that only computer science people can use optimization algorithm. Nothing like that. Because optimization algorithm has its application in all the domains. Okay, there is no restriction for that. So coming to the control of insulin, in our real world, people are creating everything artificially. Am I right or wrong? They are most people are trying to recreate human brain artificially. They are doing a lot. There are a lot of research going on artificial intelligence. So one such example is shown here. I am going to create an artificial pancreas. Okay, we all know the purpose of pancreas in our human body is to work, inject insulin in our body. Okay, so based on the level of blood sugar level variations in our body, okay, the pancreas will deliver the insulin. Okay, so this is normally happening in our body, but how can we do it artificially? By using an optimization algorithm, we can do that. Okay, we will take the insulin delivery as an input and minimizing the blood sugar deviations as an objective function output. Okay, so based on my input, I have to minimize blood sugar deviations. Okay, in my case, my body, so blood sugar level is deviated from the normal level, because whether it is increasing or decreasing. Okay, automatically the insulin delivery will be the appropriate insulin level will be given to my body. Okay, so but the end result is I should minimize the blood sugar deviation. Okay, it should be closer to the normal value. Okay, to get the normal value, I need to give the pancreas should deliver the insulin at the appropriate level. Okay, so this is also a very good example for optimization. Here my input is insulin, and my output is, my objective is blood sugar deviation, minimization of blood sugar deviation. Okay, accordingly I will get the insulin delivery from my artificial pancreas. Okay. Then the designing. Yes, the previous one is a medical domain. And this designing of airplane wings is aeronautical domain. Okay, here also you will use optimization. Okay, here I am going to design the wing, okay, so that the weight of the plane, airplane, get reduced. Okay, minimum weight is going to be my objective. To minimize the weight, what will be my wing design? Okay, for that, what are all the parameters I have to give as an input? Okay, so these are all the things involved in the optimization problem of airplane design. Okay, so this one is on the business side. Okay, I forgot to change the title. Actually, it is stock market maximization of returns. Okay, so here you can see I am going to give the stock portfolio as the input. Okay, for that particular stock, the share, how come I maximize my returns? Okay, this is what happening in stock market, right? So here my input is my stock or share value, and my output is going to be maximum returns. So this here the problem is a maximization problem. Okay, for a particular share value, if I am buying a particular share value, okay, how come I maximize the return? Okay, there are a lot of shares out there in the market, stock market. Buying which share will give me a better maximum return? Okay, that will be decided by my optimization algorithm. Then controlling a temperature in a chemical reaction. Okay, chemical reaction, the reactor, temperature plays a very important role so that we can maximize the purity of the end result. Okay, so how come I decide my temperature for a particular reaction? That will be decided by the optimization algorithm with the reactor temperature as the input and maximizing the product purity as well. Okay, so maximizing the product purity is going to be my objective function. How come I maximize the purity? For that, how much temperature is needed? That will be decided by my optimization algorithm. Okay. So we have seen a number of examples in the day regarding the optimization technique. Okay. So what are all the terms used in optimization technique? Okay, that is what we are going to see now. Okay. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Please reply. Am I audible to all of you? Okay, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
So, now we are going to see the terms used in optimization. So, what are all the terms involved in optimization? Means the first thing is objective function. Then the decision variables are control variables. Then the gradients. Then the constraints. Then the whether the variable which we are taken as a control variable, whether it is a continuous variable or discrete variable or binary variable, that should be known. Then the integer or binary, that's what I have already told. Then the language, a modeling language, and then the solver compiler. So these are all the important terms used in the optimization. So we will see each and every one elaborately. The first one is the objective function. It is what I told. Yeah, for any optimization problem, if you want to solve that particular optimization problem, you need to know your objective. That is the first and foremost thing. Okay, it is the value which we try to optimize. We are going to get the main objective is to identify the optimal input to get the desired output. But the output is determined by the subjective function. Okay, we are going to optimize that particular objective function only so that we will get the desired input. So for that, what we are going to do, I have shown you a simple example here. Okay, I have shown you a square here. Okay. My problem here is a maximization problem. I am going to maximize the area of this particular square. Okay, so what is my objective here? My objective is here is going to be the area. Okay, I am going to maximize the area of this particular curve. Okay, sorry, the area of this particular square. So to maximize this particular square, how come I maximize? By maximizing the area. So my objective function is going to be area. Okay, so here you can see I'm going to take the area as the objective function. So the main goal of objective function is to improve the value of objective function. Okay, but in case I am taking the maximization of area as my objective function, what I have to do is I have to maximize that area of the particular square. Okay, I have to maximize the area of the particular square. Okay. So this is what objective function is. Okay. So there are in terms of objective function, we have two kinds of objective function available in optimization techniques. The first one is single objective, where we involve only one objective function, and the other one is multiple objective function. We have more than one objective functions. Okay. So in case of multiple objective function, what is the case is that we have more than one objective function. So what happens is the two objectives, the one or more objective functions which we are having. Okay, will conflict with each other. Conflict means, you know the meaning of conflict, I think so. Okay, they won't aid each other, they oppose each other. Okay, so we are going to optimize two contradictory objective functions in multiple objective. Okay, in majority of cases, we will have conflict objective functions. And in very rare cases, we will have aiding objective functions. Okay, so usually in the optimization problem, the objective function will be determined. The form shown in this slide. Okay, if it is a minimization problem, it will be written like this. Min of x, okay, as a min of x. Min means what? I'm going to minimize what? Yeah, function. Function is nothing but my objective function, which is nothing but f of x. Okay. So this is how we generally represent the objective function. Minimize, I'm going to minimize a function, which is called as f of x. Okay, that's a simple. So what are all this in common sum? Some of the objective functions which we come across in different problem domains are shown here. One is cost. Okay, mostly we will try to reduce the cost for any cost related issues. Okay, if I am planning to install a particular electrical device in the system, so the first and foremost thing I will do is I will try to reduce the cost. Okay, so that it is affordable for everyone who are going to use the particular. So cost is cost is one example in which I have to reduce the operating cost. Then speed depends on our application. I may have to really increase or decrease the speed. Likewise, weight is also based on the application. I have to reduce or increase the weight. Profit, we always try to maximize the profit. So most probably profit will come in a maximization problem. Waste, we always have to reduce the level of waste. So it will be a minimization problem. So likely based on the need, and application, you will decide whether it will be a maximized objective function or minimized objective function. Okay. That was told, that was shown in the last point. Depend on the problem to be solved and the goals in solving it. Okay, based on my problem and my requirement, I will decide whether it will be a minimization problem or maximization problem. So coming to the decision variables. In the previous objective function slide, I have told you that in order to maximize the area of a particular square, I am going to take the area as my objective function. That is fine. But how come I maximize? For that, I need a control variable. Okay. By controlling a particular variable, I can maximize that objective function. So what is my control variable here? You can see here, my control variable is nothing but the size of the square. Am I right or wrong? How come I increase the size? How come I maximize the area of the square? I can maximize the area of the square only by varying my sides of the square. Am I right or wrong? Because area of the square is what? Product of two sides. Okay. Here the first square sides are going to be same. Whereas in case it is a rectangle, sides are going to be different. Okay. So here the decision variable is nothing but the sides. Okay. By taking the size as input, I can maximize that area, which is my objective function. Okay. So here my control variable is nothing but my sides of the squares is my control variable here. Okay, how I will represent for a single control variable. Okay, here I have taken side as a control variable. So for a square, for maximizing the area of square application, I have taken side as a control variable. So for that, I can represent that as a single square. Here I have only one control variable, which is a side. So I have mentioned the PRS, but it is not going to be same for all applications. Okay, some applications there will be more than one control variable. Okay, for example, take a rectangle. Okay, that we have two sides. For square, the sides are going to be same. If I am not going to represent f of x, then I have to represent as f of x1 and x2. The x1 and x2 of x. So in case we are having side control variables, I can represent the objective function as minimization of the minimization problem. I will expect what indicates by control variable minimization problem, which optimizes. Okay, so I can get a better objective function. Validation variable. Then coming to the gradients. Okay, gradients is nothing but the differential thing. The first one is if you are taking a slope, you can see here. Okay, here the slope may be increasing one or decreasing. That's what I told. For example, if we are working on a two dimension and I am having a spread. Okay, if I am increasing my value, okay, my y value is increasing means I will get a positive slope. Okay, if I am increasing my x value and my y value is increasing means it will give say a negative slope. Okay, this is for a two-dimensional problem. Okay, in case I am having multiple dimensions. Okay, but if I am having more than two, okay, means it is not easy to identify this slope. Okay, for that purpose we will go for gradients. Okay, if you involve only two dimensions means we will go for slope. If we have multiple dimensions means we will go for gradient. Okay. So these gradients are useful in analytical, numerical, and differential parts. And whenever we are using optimization technique on analytical side, when we are implementing optimization technique on analytical part side, we will use this gradient to attain the maximum value. So the most common approach to optimization problem, to solve this optimization problem, are MATLAB. MATLAB is very common. You all know, I think so. Okay. We are all familiar with MATLAB. So then we have CAMS, then we have Homer, etc. So these are all different softwares which can perform the optimization. Okay. So coming to the constraints. I will take the same square problem. Okay. So coming to the constraints. This is what I mentioned in the earlier slide. Okay. Constraints is nothing but a limits or boundary. Okay. Within which we have to organizational problem. So I am going to take the same square problem. Okay, I am going to maximize the area of the square. Here is my control variable. For this, what is my constraint? Okay, my constraint is the product of the sides should be less than A. Okay, it is an inequality constraint. But the equality constraint is the summation of these two should be equal to 20. Okay, so these are constraints. Okay, the general optimization technique, we have two types of constraints. One is inequality, which will involve the lesser than or greater than values, okay, range. The other one is equality constraints, are the addition, summation or subtraction of two control variables equal to a particular. Okay, so these are all the constraints which involve the optimization problem. It is a kind of boundaries which is applied to the optimization problem. Okay. The thing is, I have shown you a diagram here on the right hand side. I am rolling a ball from a slope. Okay. This ball is rolling and it should end at a particular point. Okay. This ball, like I mentioned, a ball, okay, that is the constraint. We are not mentioning any ball and the ball is keep on rolling. How come I can obtain a solution? It is not possible. Okay, the ball keep on rolling. I need to identify the minimum point which the ball makes. Okay. If I am not mentioning any constraint, the ball will keep on rolling. It will rolling and keep on rolling, and I am not able to attain a solution. Okay, to attain a solution, we need to provide the boundary limits to the optimization problem. Okay, which is nothing but the ball here. Once the ball hits the ball, it will stop here and that will be the minimum point. Okay. So what are all the examples of a constraints? Okay. I have told you two real-time examples for optimization problem. My previous slides. So you can see here, the first one is based on that, I have shown you for those problems. Bridge with a constant that must be hold at least 8,000 volts. This is what problem I have shown. Right? I am going to give the design as input and I am going to get the maximum loading as maximizing the loading as my output. Okay, my objective function is to maximize the loading. Up to which point I have to maximize? Okay, that is the thing. Here, for that, you have to put some boundary limits. You have to put some range. Okay. So that is here. That is here 8,000 volts. Okay. So my bridge will be designed. Okay. Up to a maximum loading of 80,000 volts. Okay. Likewise, if I have mentioned you a chemical example, a chemical reaction example, in which the chemical mixture should at least have 99% purity. So that is the constraint. If I am performing optimization problem and I am varying my temperature to maximize the purity of my reaction, okay, in that chemical reaction problem, optimization problem. If my purity is 80%, okay, my optimization problem will not converge. Okay, it will keep on trying, it will keep on changing the temperature so that I can get a purity level of closer to 99%. So that is the constraint. Okay, so likewise, we can use the constraints, okay, so that we can attain an optimal solution within the anticipated. Okay, so these are all some examples of constraints. And coming to the optimization problem in electrical engineering, since I am from electrical engineering, some examples are we are using this optimization techniques to solve this electrical problem. Okay, I have shown those problems in my slide. First one is economic dispatch, then emission dispatch, then optimal power flow, then optimal leakage allocation in the distribution network, then optimal system reconfiguration. So these are some electrical examples in which the optimization techniques are very much useful. Okay. So coming to the variables, I am going to give some input variables, okay, for my optimization problem. What are all the different types of variables available regarding optimization problems? We have continuous variables, we have discrete variables, and then we have binary variables. Okay, we are from the names of you easily understand what is continuous variables. Okay, it represents a continuous range of values. Okay, whereas in discrete variables, we will have a decided set of values, not able to change or not able to get any independent values. Okay, but from example itself, you can easily understand. In continuous variables, the example is speed, weight, and sex. Okay, in case my speed is 50 kilometers per hour, I can change that to 50.5, or else I can change it. 51, 52.5. Likewise, I can change continuously. Whereas in discrete variables, you can see the example is nothing but the number of poles drilled in a board. Okay, in that particular board, I can drill only a desired set of holes. Okay, that bore will occupy only a desired set of holes. Okay, at a particular diameter. So it is a discrete variable. Okay, I can't get a valve in between. Okay, so I can get only a desired set of values from drilled value, drilled force from that particular hole. Okay, this is the example for the discrete variable. Binary, we have only two values. It is 0 or 1. Okay, the examples are already provided there. Okay, so in optimization problem, has the capability to deal with any of these variables. It can handle continuous variable, it can handle discrete variable, and also it can handle binary variables. Okay. So coming to the optimization, different types of optimization algorithms. Okay, what are all the different types of algorithms available in the literature? The thing is, we have a gradient-based optimization algorithm and then gradient-free optimization algorithm. Okay, the gradient-based algorithms are called analytical approaches, analytical algorithms. Okay, all conventional algorithms come under this category, gradient-based algorithm category. Okay, so examples are linear programming, nonlinear programming, quadratic programming, mixed integer nonlinear programming, so mixed integer linear programming. So these are all analytical techniques, okay, which involves a gradient based solution process. Okay, whereas gradient free algorithms are all heuristic optimization techniques, which is inspired from nature or bio inspired based algorithms. Okay, so examples are genetic algorithm, particle swarm optimization algorithm, and colony algorithm. There are a lot of algorithms are there in the text, okay, regarding the gradient free algorithms. Okay, so coming to the gradient based algorithm. Okay, gradient based algorithm. I have shown you a simple example here. Okay, hill descent control. Hill descent control. So in this particular problem, I'm going to use derivatives to find the optimal value of the function. Okay, so how come I determine the optimal value here? Okay, for a particular descending function. Here is a descending function, so it is a minimization problem. So I need to identify the minimum point. Okay, so I have to determine the minimum. So for that, what are all the three steps in this algorithm? First, I need to search the direction, okay, using gradient. Using gradient slope, you can easily identify the direction. Then step says, how much distance I am going to move, okay, move in a particular direction. Then convergence check, whether I have reached that particular optimal point. That is my convergence check. So in this simple hill descent control, I have, my algorithm involves three steps. Okay, so all these three steps are important. And it is based on gradient, based on the slope. Yeah, in hill descent, if you analyze the slope, that's what I told in the earlier example. When the point at which the slope is equal to zero, okay, that is the point you will have, either you will have a maximum or minimum. Okay, whether it is the maximum value, means your slope value changes from negative to positive. Okay, before that zero value, because before that zero point, okay, so having a negative slope. After the zero point, we have before the zero point, we have positive slope, and after that zero point, we have negative slope, which indicates a maximum point. Likewise, before the zero value, if you have a negative slope, and after the zero value, we have a positive slope, means it indicates a minimum point. Okay, so likewise, using gradient, you can identify the maximum and minimum point. So here, still since it is a hill descent control, we will identify the minimum point using the gradient. Okay, likewise, using the gradient, you can identify the direction, and also step size. Also, you can determine how much distance a particular vehicle can move so that it can attain the minimum point. Yeah, likewise, I can check the convergence, means whether it attains the required point is my convergence check. Okay, so all these things can be performed using the gradient based algorithms. Here, I have used gradient method to identify the search direction. Okay, so these are all gradient based algorithms. But what are all the advantages and disadvantages of gradient based algorithms? Advantages are, it is widely used because it is easily scalable. Scalable means if you identify the derivative, you can easily identify the solution. Okay, but how easy it is to identify the derivatives, that the problem lies. Okay, so what is the disadvantages for this regarding this gradient based algorithms are, it requires smooth gradient. That's what I told. Okay, if the gradient is smooth, means you can easily identify the solution. So gradient is not smooth. If your input variables are not continuous or it is discrete, okay, it is like in case it is lot of disturbance are there in input variables, then it is really difficult to solve using the gradient based algorithms. Okay, so in that case, we will go. This gradient based algorithm is not efficient. Okay, also computationally it will be expensive. Okay, in terms of computation side also it will be very expensive because you have to do lot of calculations. Okay, to perform this gradient based algorithms, it involves a lot of mathematical calculations. Okay, so coming to the gradient free algorithm, from the name itself you can see it does not require any derivatives. Okay, we are not going to use any mathematical derivative differentiations here. Okay, because where we are going to use gradient algorithms, we are going to use these gradient free algorithms where derivative for a problem, identify the derivative for a problem is get. Okay, so that's what I told. It's a simple problem. It involves only two dimensions. You can easily identify the derivative. In case it is not a simple problem, it is a complex problem where multiple dimensions are involved, it is really difficult to identify the derivative. So in that case, I am going for my gradient free algorithm. Okay, so it will optimizes all type of variables. It will optimizes the discrete, discontinuous, as well as noisy variables. So that is one of the major advantages of gradient free algorithm. Okay, what are the disadvantage means? It is somewhat slower in terms of computation compared to gradient search algorithm, and also the search process is somewhat exhaustive. Okay, expensive and exhaustive. Examples are genetic PSO or genetic algorithm. PSO algorithms you can apply a lot of. Okay, in which we are exhaustive. Coming to the essence of an optimization algorithm, what are all the things involved in an optimization? I mean, gradient free algorithm. What are the things are there? You will have objective function, which is subjected to constraints. That's it. How come I define that? It is the process of searching for an optimal solution to a particular problem of interest and various constraints. That's what I do. Okay, you have to find the optimal solution for your problem. Okay, under various constraints. Okay, for the derivative. So that is what the essence of any optimization. You need to identify the optimal solution. Okay, under subject to various constraints. Okay, so that you will get what optimized input values. Okay, so coming to the optimization algorithms, these are all the different types. Okay, we have these are all the different classifications involved in any optimization algorithms. Okay, you can see we have deterministic, we have stochastic, and then we have hybrid. What is deterministic? Deterministic is nothing but all conventional algorithms comes under deterministic. Conventional means RNP. Mathematical. Okay, what are all example is gradient based algorithms. Just now we have seen gradient based algorithms. Okay, all the gradient based algorithms comes under the deterministic algorithms. Okay, so it involves analytical approach, mathematical calculations. Okay, examples I already told. Okay, linear programming, nonlinear programming, string feature analytic programming, all are deterministic algorithms. Okay, so for stochastic means. It is a non-gradient gradient free algorithm. Okay, under stochastic we have two classifications: heuristics and meta-heuristics. Okay, heuristics. What is the difference between heuristics and meta-heuristics? Means heuristics is optimization problem where you will have only one solution. And you will have only one solution, and based on the solution, only you will have your solution process. But in meta-heuristics, you will have a population, you will have a set of populations, and each population will have a solution. Okay, so based on that set of populations, that's what the difference between heuristic and meta-heuristic. And the last one is hybrid. Hybrid is nothing but you are going to hybridize the strength of two algorithms. Okay, some algorithm will have a better exploration capability, some algorithm will have some better exploitation capability. So, one hybrid algorithm, what I'm going to do is I am going to hybridize the strength of one algorithm, okay, and other algorithm. Okay, if some algorithm have better exploration, I will take that algorithm for exploration part. And if some algorithm have better exploitation, I will take that algorithm for exploitation. So that I can attain a better global solution. Okay, so these are all different. different types of optimization algorithms, classifications. Okay. So, because the gradient we have already seen the conventional algorithms. Okay, I mean, here we are going to see the meta heuristic algorithms, which are gradient free algorithms, okay, which is population based methods. Here you can see the heuristic. Okay, what is the purpose of heuristic thing is? But what I am going to have one solution and I am going to update the solution to get a better value, better solution value. Okay, initially I will have one solution and then I will update the one particular solution so that I can get a better optimized value. I will upper the level of search. How can I upper the level of search? I can upper the level of search by including a population of solutions. Okay, if I am having n number of solutions, I can update those solutions so that it also the search space efficiently and I can obtain a better global optimal solution. Okay, so that is the advantage of using. Okay. Okay. So, what are all the problem heuristic algorithms which are used in day-to-day problems and also in literature? Genetic algorithms. These are also old algorithms. Genetic algorithms somewhat old, and also PSO is somewhat old. That morning search. Then teacher learning based on optimization, backward coding algorithm, man-calling optimization, artificial deep learning, gravitational firefly. From looking into the name itself, you can easily come to an judgment that these algorithms are inspired by nature. That's what I told, that all heuristic and meta-heuristic algorithms are inspired from nature. Okay. Also, they are gradient free. That's why they are gradient. They are inspired from nature, whereas gradient algorithms they are inspired from mathematical language. Okay, so that is the difference between deterministic and heuristic algorithms. So coming to genetic algorithms, I am going to give you a simple introduction about genetic algorithms. What is genetic algorithm? So in that front, I will tell you what is happening inside genetic algorithm. Okay, I will give you a short introduction about genetic algorithm, and then I will the objective part. So we all know what is Darwin's theory, okay? Survival of the fittest. So this genetic algorithm is going to mimic that Darwin's theory. Okay. So what is happening in the genetic algorithm is, okay, what are all the components of genetic algorithm is? We will have an initial population. Okay, in that for the initial population, we are going to have fitness value. Okay, so after evaluating the fitness, we will have few genetic operators where selection, crossover, mutation occurs. With this GA operators, the solution which we already evaluated for the initial population gets updated. Okay, that is the purpose of having the genetic algorithm operators. So in genetic algorithm, we have two types. It is binary genetic algorithm, scale coded genetic algorithm. Here in this presentation, I am going to explain only binary genetic algorithm. Okay, real coded is somewhat easy when compared to binary. So you can easily understand if you are G, you can easily answer the real coded GA. Okay. So coming to the flowchart. So what I am going to do now is first I am going to initialize the population. Let me take some number of population. Okay, I am going to take 10 number of population. Okay, for the 10 number of population, I am going to evaluate what the fitness value. Fitness is nothing but the absolute dimension value. Okay, after evaluating the absolute dimension, I am going to select the parent. Parent is nothing but in case out of this 10 values, in case I am taking some minimization problem, some out of 10 population, I am getting better results for 6 population. I will take those 6 as a parent. Okay. So what happens is that parent will produce 2 offspring. Okay. I have taken 6 parents and I will form a pair. Okay. I will form a pair for each parents. Okay. So you can see in the 6 number of parents, I can form how many pairs? I can form 3 pairs. Okay. Okay, so these three pairs of parents, okay, will produce two offsprings. Each pair will produce two offsprings. Okay, that happen using crossover. Okay, once that crossover happens, okay, I will have two offsprings. And the mutation, what I will do is I will do some modifications in that offspring so that I can get an updated value from the parent. Initially, I have a solution. So from that, I have taken the best solution. Out of my case, if I am taking 10 solutions, I am taking the best 6 from that solution. How I am taking, going to display the best means, in case if I am handling a minimization problem, I will take the minimized value, the most minimized value, this value as a parent. Okay, from that parent, I make a parent. Okay, if I am taking 6 parents, I will make 3 parents, and each parent will produce 2 offsprings. Okay. So it will produce 2 offsprings. That offsprings, in that offspring, it will make some modifications using the mutation operator. Okay, finally, what will happen? I will have an updated offspring, which is moved to the optimization process. So that for that updated offspring, I can evaluate the objective function again. So what happens? The objective function which is evaluated for the updated offspring is going to be better when compared to my parent selection. Okay, so that's what happening in G algorithm. I have shown you an example here. You can see here. It will be very easy to understand. Okay. This is a binary GA. You can see here in crossover. I have taken 2 chromosomes. These chromosomes are my parents. Okay. Chromosome 1, chromosome 2. Okay. So the first one is single point crossover. What I am going to do here is in each chromosome, I take some number of bits. Okay. So in this, I am going to divide this, okay, into 2. You can see a black line here, which will separate this chromosome. Okay. Likewise, I will separate chromosome 2 also. So what I am going to do is how I am going to generate the offspring is I am going to sort one of the divided part. Okay, you can see here in the offspring 1, offspring 2. Okay, the second part, you can see the second part here. Okay, the second part of chromosome 2 is moved to the second part of chromosome 2, and the second what is the second part of chromosome 2. That is what offspring 1 and offspring 2 is. Okay, likewise, here I can take and the next one I have taken 2-point crossover. Okay, I can 2-point means I have separated the given number of bits into 3 sections. Okay. And then I am going to start only 1 section. Okay, that is the middle one. You can see the one is nothing but starting. Moving the second part of chromosome 2 to chromosome 1 is my offspring 1. And moving the second part of chromosome 1 to chromosome 2 is my offspring 2. So like this, I can make crossover. I already have applied the solution. In that, I have taken the best solution. In the best solution, I am going to make this crossover. Okay. So after doing this crossovers, I am going to mutate. How I am going to mutate? Mutate is nothing but inside this, in each offsprings, you have the bit values, right? So in that bit values, I am going to change any 2 values. Okay, randomly. Okay, in case here, I am taking a 10 bit value. In this, I am going to change 3 and 8 randomly. Randomly, I am going to select 3 and 8. Okay, in case if I am having 1 and 3, I will convert to 0. Okay, in case if it is 0 and 8, I will convert that to 1. Okay, I will change like this. Okay, I am swapping the. Okay, this is what happened in mutation. So once we update this offspring, automatically what will happen? I will get an updated fitness value. Okay, I can see here. So in this way, I can make our mutation operation in genetic. Okay, so that is the genetic part. Then coming to the multi-adjective part. Okay, I already told. In the optimization problem, we have two types of problem solving. Okay, one is single objective, another one is multi-objective. In single objective, from the name itself, you can easily identify you have only one objective. Whereas in multi-objective, you have more than one objective. Okay, two or more objectives. Okay, in single objective problem, it's easy to solve. Okay, it is very easy to solve. whether it may be using analytical approach, it involves mathematical calculation, not of mathematics. But meta-heuristic techniques you can easily evaluate the problem. But multi-objective problem is not going to be easy. Okay, because you are going to optimize two or more objectives simultaneously. So for that, okay, the computation is going to be different. Okay, the procedure of computation is going to be different when compared to single object. Whether it may be analytical method or heuristic method, the procedure is going to be different. Okay. So in multi-objective problem, I already mentioned we have two or more objectives, and the two commonly used methods are that in multi-objective optimization. One is weighted sum approach, the other one is Pareto-based approach. Okay. So first we will this already just a minute. Okay. First we will see what is weighted sum approach. Okay, weighted sum approach is nothing but we will allow we are having two objectives. Okay, let me tell you, you have two objectives. So what we are going to do in weighted sum approach is we will assign a weight to the two objectives manually. Okay, manually we will assign a weight to the two objectives. Okay, it should be within one. Okay, in case if I am giving 0.5 as an weight to one object, I am going to give 0.5 to the other. Okay, so in that way I can equally distribute, not equally distribute. In case if I am 3, I need to distribute the weights accordingly so that the summation of all the weights is equal to 1. Okay, like that I need to distribute the weight. So what is the disadvantage of weighted sum method? Since I am pre-allocating the weight, okay, in case I am having three attributes, it is not possible for me to allocate the weight equally. If it is two, I can do it by 0.5 and 0.5. In case if it is three or four more, what happens is I can't be able to distribute the weight equally. Okay, so what happens? One objective will optimize better when compared to the other. Okay, which may result in conflict. Okay, to avoid that, we are going for Pareto-based methods. Pareto-based method, what we are going to use, quite what we are going to use, we are going to get a set of non-dominated Pareto optimal solutions. Okay, this is very, very important. Where which all objectives are optimized simultaneously. Okay, that is an important point in Pareto optimal solutions. Okay. Okay. So again, I'm weighted sum approach, I'm going to pre-allocate weights. Okay, pre-allocating the weights means what happens? I'm already allocating the weight. So based on the weight, the optimization process will be carried out. And the main disadvantage of weighted sum method is all the objective functions are not optimized simultaneously since we are pre-allocating manually. Whereas in Pareto-based method, all the objective functions, multiple objective functions are optimized simultaneously. Okay, without giving priority to one or other. Okay, so Pareto method is somewhat more advantage and somewhat more efficient in solving multi-objective problem when compared to weighted sum method. Okay, so how we are going to perform multi-objective optimization using Pareto-based method? That is what we are going to see in the upcoming slides. Okay, how we are going to solve the Pareto-based multi-objective optimization. So we all know majority of applications, whether maybe engineering or whatever domain it is, yeah, majority of real world applications, we have multi-objective optimization problems. Okay, we are not supposed to solve only one objective. For example, I will tell you one thing. Since I am from Electrica, I will give you an electrical example. I am going to install a particular device in a system, in an electrical system. Okay, it may be a distributed generation unit or whatever it is. Okay, I am going to install a DG unit. Let me take this DG unit. I am going to install a DG unit in a distribution system. By installing the DG units, what I have to analyze? What is my objective? My objective is to minimize the system power losses. That is going to be one of my objectives. Whether minimizing loss alone is this is not the case. In electrical, we have a lot of electrical parameters. Apart from loss, I have voltage. Okay, apart from loss, I have voltage. And then I have the reliability. Okay, and then I have the line loading. A lot of electrical other objectives are there. If I am focusing only on class, okay, it will impact other objectives. So I have to consider all the other objectives also in my optimization process. That is what one day objective optimization is. Okay, I am not going to focus on only one particular objective function, whether it is a power loss. Okay, I am going to touch all the other objective functions so that I can decide what is the best location to install the particular region. Okay, I am going to install it. What are the location I have to install? That will be decided by my optimization problem. How it is decided? Based on optimizing the multiple objectives. So that in case objective functions are optimized, okay, simultaneously, getting a better location, that I will locate the region. Okay. So this is what happened in multiple optimization. How we can identify the best solution means here we will get a trade-off of solutions. Okay, we will get a trade-off of solutions. Okay. Because the thing is, I have shown an example here. Okay, you take this one. Instead of going for theoretical part straight away, you just consider this example. This is a normal common x. Okay, you can see here. In x axis, I have taken a cost, and the y axis, I have taken number. What I am going to do is, I am going to buy a car. Yeah, I am going to buy a car. The thing is, for buying the car, I have two objectives. One is cost. Okay, the other is comfort. What should be my ideology? My ideology should be, I need to buy the car with somewhat reduced cost, but at the same time, I am not able to compromise on my comfort. Okay, both are competing in nature, am I right or wrong? Because if you are increasing your cost, okay, your comfort will increase only if you increase the cost, am I right or wrong? Okay, if you increase your cost, you will get the comfort. Okay, so both are conflicting in nature. Okay, one is my focus is to reduce the cost to get maximum comfort. Okay, so one side I have to minimize the cost, and other side I have to maximize the comfort. Am I right or wrong? Okay, my focus is to reduce the cost with greater comfort. What it indicates is cost is a minimization problem and comfort is a maximization problem. Okay, because I have to reduce my cost, okay, but at the same time I have to enhance my comfort level. So these are all multiple conflicting objectives. This is conflict in nature. Okay, this kind of problem should be solved using the multi-objective optimization problem. Okay, using paradox. Okay, here you have a set of paradox. Here I will show you that. You can see here. Okay, you can see here. This is not the important diagram related to Pareto form. Okay, how I will form this Pareto form in multi-objective optimization. You can see here. This is my initial solutions. Okay, initially I will take some population. For the population, I will get its initial solutions. Here you can see these initial solutions are dominated solutions. What it indicates dominated means we have solutions. Much better when compared with these initial solutions. Okay, these red color dots are dominated solutions. Dominated solution means these solutions are dominated by some other solutions. Okay, so we are not going to take these initial solutions into our optimization process. Okay, since they are dominated, we are not going to consider here. Here we have one red color line. Sorry, here we have one green box, right? Green color boxes are there, which forms a row front. Okay, that is called my Pareto form. Okay, what it indicates is here I have a set of solutions which are non-terminative. Non-terminative means if I am taking a 10 number of population, okay, I have taken 10 number of populations. Out of 10, for the 10 population, I am going to get 10 solutions. Okay, I am going to get 10 solutions. In the 10 solutions, the five green boxes which we are shown here are non-terminated. What it indicates is the solutions which attain for this five population is non-terminated. What it indicates, it is not dominated by other solutions. Okay, it is not dominated by other solutions. So it is the better solution which forms a Pareto front like this. So what I am going to do, I am going to pick one of this solution from this Pareto front as my optimal solution. This is part of fundamental agility optimization. Okay, so this is what happening in Pareto-based multi-agility optimization. Okay. Okay, with this, I will wind up the general introduction about optimization technique. If you have any doubt in this, you can ask. Am I audible to all of you? Please, am I audible to all of you? Am I audible?
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So with this, I will wind up the morning session. Okay, this is a general introduction about optimization technique, and I hope you understand that the basics about single as well as multi-objective optimization. Yeah, I have a question. How to get the optimal solution from Pareto? Actually, the thing is, see, here you have a set of Pareto solutions, right? Front one, I showed you in this slide, some set of solutions like that in the Pareto front. In there, I have to pick the best one. How I can pick the best one? For that, lot of solution methodologies are there. Okay, you can use a fuzzy based approach, okay, fuzzy logic based approach, in which, okay, you can form a set of rules. Okay, form a set of rules. Rules mean what? This is my maximum value of objective one. No, this is the minimum value of my objective. Okay, this is the maximum value of objective two in case of multiple objectives. This is the minimum objective two. So with this ranges, okay, with this ranges, you can frame, okay, you can formulate, okay, you can formulate set of rules in fuzzy. You can frame a set of rules so that you can attain the best compromise solution from the Pareto. Okay, a lot of research papers are already there, which they have used fuzzy decision making to determine the best optimal solution from the Pareto. Okay, so in fuzzy logic, what we have to use our common knowledge to frame the rules. Okay. Then from the rules we will come to a decision. Here, how we can frame the rules? We can frame the rules by mentioning the range of my objective function values which are available in the Pareto form. Okay, minimum, maximum value. So in that range, I have to pick one of the solution as my optimized solution. Okay, fuzzy decision making is one approach. Then we have a Rolle-Thiele criterion. That is the other one. In Rolle-Thiele criterion, what you have to do is you have to pick randomly one of the solutions from the Pareto front, which should be from the least crowded segment. It should be from the least crowded segment. The reason is, if you are picking from the most crowded, means almost the values are going to be same. Okay, least crowded means automatically what happens? That value is somewhat optimal compared to the other value. Okay, so you can for that also you can find the extensive knowledge about Rolle-Thiele criterion in a lot of research papers. There are already that which involves multi-objective optimization process. Okay, you have a fuzzy-based decision making approach, then you have Rolle-Thiele approach, which are most commonly used to attain the best solution from the panel. Okay, is it okay for you, sir? Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. So most commonly they will use fuzzy-based decisioning in selecting the best compromise solution from the Pareto front. Okay, it will be better compared to Rolle-Thiele because in Rolle-Thiele criterion, there are chances that the non-optimal solution may get less the optimal solution. Okay, the chances are because we are picking randomly, but in fuzzy decision making, it is not the case. It is more accurate in terms of Rolle-Thiele criterion. Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Okay. Okay. Regarding the application of this optimization algorithm, application of optimization single as well as multi-objective in power system domain, and you can verify my Google Scholar profile. My papers are available there. Okay. In that, I have implemented both single objective as well as multi-objective. Multi-objective using heuristic optimization techniques. Okay, so you can refer my paper to get a better understanding regarding the applications of single as well as multi-objective optimization regarding power system problems. Okay, I will just simply Google search Arulraj space R. Okay, Arulraj space R. I will type my name in the comment box. Okay, just Google search here. In that, the first or second link, you will find my Google Scholar profile. Okay, in that my papers are there. You can easily, since I already given you an introduction about single objective as well as multi-objective problem domain, you can easily understand the application, power system applications I have implemented in my papers. Okay, in that I have applied both single objective as well as multiple objective. Okay, so if you have time. Just go through those papers so that you will get a better understanding how signal and multi objectives are implemented in power system problems. I have done optimal allocation of each unit distribution. That is my research area. So I run my works based on that each allocation problem. In that, I have used both single objective as well as multiple objective. So in case you are interested, you want to go to those papers, you can find my papers in that Google Scholar. Okay, any other questions? I am being treated. Okay, I will give you my mail ID also. In case you have any queries regarding this presentation, or if you have any other queries regarding implementing optimization technique in power system, you can get to my mail ID. I will mention my mail ID in the comment section. Okay. In case you have inquiries, you can mail me to my mail. Okay. Okay. Thank you. So with this, I will wind up this third session. If you have any questions, you can feel free to ask.
Any questions from the participants? Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful presentation.
Okay.
And optimization. So the next session starts at 2:00. So the resource person for that session is Dr. N. Kumarappan, IEEE chairperson, Madras section. So all are requested to join the third final session at 2:00. And now the participants are requested to fill the attendance form for third session. Thank you.